So picking up with this story again, when Muhammad died, there then arose the question of the succession. By that stage, Islam had grown, and there was a lot of people following the faith, and so there was a question of a succession, and the succession was as between Aisha, who was Muhammad's wife, and her descendants, and on the other hand, there were the companions of Muhammad, and claims amongst them as to who Muhammad had said should succeed from him. And so the Shia Islam on the one hand is based on the claims of the of Muhammad's companions, lieutenants, call them what you will, and Aisha, his wife. Now, so again, you've got this idea that, well, who carries forward the responsibility for the prophecies handed down? So it's actually a similar story to the Abraham story, except it's a discussion amongst men regarding the succession to Muhammad, and in the Abrahamic story, it's God basically says, no, you're going to have a son with Sarah, and that's Isaac, and from there we then get to the promised land by the 400 years bit. So and then we Christians have Jesus Christ. So within then Christianity itself, when Jesus was crucified, you then have Paul and the various Gospels and the story up to 300 or 400 BC, and the Council of Nicaea, the Council of Euphrates. This is not a lecture, or you know, a discourse on, you know, scripture, or you know, theological history. The point I want to make about the Nicene Creed up to around 1000, when there was the schism between the Eastern Orthodox Church and the Catholic Church, you also have this other thing amongst men splitting off into factions. And you have that in Judaism as well. Now we're getting to the point I wanted to make. In this novel that I'm writing, I've been studying various characters. I mean, one of the characters that I'm going into it is a chap that goes by the glories in the title on Twitter of Nasher Jew, and he is a witch finder general for the campaign against Jeremy Corbyn about anti-Semitism in the Labour Party. But so there are these disputes amongst men who set themselves up as the arbiters of who's a good Jew, who's a bad Jew, who's a good Christian, who's a bad Christian, who's a good Muslim, who's a bad Muslim. Now, I've been studying this week a lot of videos on YouTube from Speaker's Corner, and there's one guy called Bob who's a Christian guy that goes down there and preaches and argues with it seems mostly Muslim guys. There's a guy called Ali Dawa who Tommy Robinson doesn't seem to like very much, or they seem to have this kind of mutual ongoing feud, which is a shame, because I've grown to actually enjoy Ali Dawa, and I've watched a number of his videos and discussions, the famous video of he and Tommy Robinson having their great sort of argument doesn't show either of them in a very good light, sadly. There's another guy called Ali Hijab, and I really like Ali Hijab. I mean, if you've watched the Day of Freedom, Freedom of Speech rally on Whitehall, where lots of people turned up to speak Sargon of Akkad, what's that guy with the whiskers, the libertarian guy from Canada, Gavin McGuinness, Count Dunkela. Well, at that thing, Ali Dawa and Ali Hijab had been invited to speak, but Tommy Robinson decided that he didn't think that was okay. I think with this ongoing beef that he and Ali Dawa seem to have, and I'm not making any accusations, pronouncements, or whatever on what that's all about. The only thing I would say is that, you know, we have two ears and one mouth, and Epictetus, one of my favourite philosophers, a Stoic philosopher, suggested that we use them in that proportion. And that's something, watching these YouTube videos at Speaker's Corner, that occurred to me several times. There's one of the videos which is of a Pakistani boxing coach from up in Manchester who approaches this guy Bob and, you know, having a chat, I'd like to put, you know, our community side of thing and of the story. And then this very humble, pious guy, this boxing coach, who's a lovely man, then listens patiently when Bob, you know, speaks over him, really. It's quite difficult to watch some of this stuff, but if you bear with it and go through it, eventually the discourses can get distilled down, and everybody learns quite a lot from doing that. or would do. I've certainly learned a hell of a lot listening to all these guys. And now, I'm going to. What I plan to do is sort of just from memory set out some of these things, and then I'll cut in some of the clips off YouTube. I mean, I've decided just to spend some time putting this together because it sort of helps me with my. It's going to help me with some dialogue and storylines, plot lines in my novel. And I also think it's a really important time at the moment for people to listen to each other and love each other rather than be divided. Now this then comes back to the question that I was at the point I was beginning to make, which is a point that Ali Hijab makes several times in several of the discussions that I've watched of him, and that is that on the question of hadith. Now hadith is scholarship of the Quran, and it has certain authority, but men are not God. Now that's something which everyone should really bear in mind. And there's a discussion between another guy. See, I mean, this title here is actually quite misleading because it says Rastafarian teaches radical Islamists a lesson. Well, the guy he's talking to.
I'm not trying to send someone out. I'm not trying to give that away. I'm not trying to.
This, he's not a radical Islamist. Now here he is here. This pastor.
I am a man, thank you.
Then to beat the Muslims who are winning.
Pastor David Lynn is really great. I mean, I watched all of that video and it really is worth watching. From both sides, this is that Bob chap here. Now the point about the Rasta video is what he says is that in terms of anybody's relationship with God, it's between them and God, you know, not by these intervening layers. Now I mean, for me, God is love and everything and everywhere, and it's not a man. I mean, the idea that we're made in the image of God, that doesn't chime with my own understanding of what the well, let's call it the whole God thing is about, or the Allah thing, or whatever. It's if you read Maimonides and his Guide for the Perplexed, you kind of get some idea of what a idealistic thing God is, because God is and isn't and everything, and so in terms of idealism and materialism, God is not a material phenomena. But we're a part of God, and so, you know, God is in all of us, but the sum of all the parts do not make up the whole. You know, this is the philosophical conceptualization of the idea of God, and as a thought experiment, to me it seems absurd to suggest that, say, God would be a jealous God, in the sense that God would have an ego, because I don't. It's men have egos, we know that. One of my favourite essays is Osho's, which is an essay called Ego, the False Centre. The other thing about ego, in terms of the seven deadly sins, pride is supposed to be the most deadly. There's a play, a morality play, that was written in the 13th century by a monk by the name of Liebermann, called Senodaxus. It's about this pious guy that dies, and his soul will go to heaven, and he keeps coming back to life, saying, you know, the thing that's blocking it is that the sin of pride was within him. He was prideful of his pious acts, and that was that's the ego thing. And that's also the narcissism thing. And with social media and so many different people being able to discuss with each other, it comes off as narcissism. And it's an easy charge to make of each other. And that comes from a competitive spirit of wanting to win arguments rather than discover truth, and this adversarial thing. This is all part of the same point about men privileging themselves to be interceding between God and the relationship of other people, men and women, with God. Say, you know, if a priest comes along and says, well, your only relationship with God can be through me, and unless you come through me, you know, sorry mate, you're not going to heaven. That doesn't work for me. And this is what the Rasta guy says in this video. So so the pride, the ego, the narcissism, the talking over each other, the division that that causes between three broad faith groups, which divide down into many faith groups, and I also would put agnostics and atheists in faith groups as well. I mean, atheism is a religion in one sense, and some of the most zealous atheists and much more zealous, in my opinion, than what people would term zealous religious nuts, say. I'm thinking of Richard Dawkins, just as a for instance. But it's the political structures and the succession arguments as to who becomes the privileged instrument through which people have to go to communicate with God. So that's when the othering comes in, when the chosenness comes in. Now, the chosenness that bothers me above anything actually is in Calvinism, which is a branch of Christianity, where they have a concept called unconditional election. Now, and that is very, the chosenness of in Judaism with respect to Israel is one thing, and that's, you know, in the Bible, and kind of but I think the point about all of this is that the structures of the modern state, in the broader sense of the term, and so, you know, things like states or similar to states have existed for, well, 7,000 years now. So I'm going to be the Akkadian civilization. I mean, again, in Conquest of Do, we go all the way back to the first sedentary populations in the Fertile Crescent on the border, which basically is between Syria and Turkey. There's a place called Gobli Tepe, which there's a guy called Graham Hancock that has done a lot of this ancient history and forgotten history stuff, you know, like the search for Atlantis and all of this sort of thing. Well, this is pre-Abrahamic faiths, so this is pre-Judaism, which is the kind of oldest Abrahamic faith, you know, obviously, in the tradition of the Bible, the unifying thing is a love for God. Now, which is an idealistic love, you know, of everything, each of the creation. The creation which is accessible to us as humans through our senses. And that's a limited experience that we have. Now, I mean, I do believe love conquers all. I mean, on the recent royal wedding of Prince Harry and Meghan Markle, the sermon from the bishop over from the Episcopalian Church in the States was brilliant, you know, about love and fire. And I mean, I actually put that up on my YouTube because that was speaking truth to power. I mean, telling power that the power of love is, you know, conquers all. And just imagine if people, you know, embrace and harness love in the same way that humanity embrace and harness fire. The story of Prometheus predates the story the bishop was telling, I thought it was brilliant, that sermon. You know, the idea of getting back to the Gospels and what have you is, you know, what I happen to, you know, the Gospels is the teachings of Jesus, and I think they're really important. I also think the Quran and the teachings of Muhammad are very important as well. But I also believe that the Torah, the Pentateuch, those first five books of the Old Testament, I think they're very important as well. I'm fond of quoting Tolstoy, who said that once materialism has written the Bible of materialism, maybe then we can dispense with religion, but until there's no better way than through the Bible stories to educate our young. Now, you know, atheists will throw their hands up in horror and say, well, what about all the bad stuff? And I would say, well, read my Maimonides and the Guide to the Perplexed, which was written for students of the Torah, but applies equally well to the New Testament, or the Quran, in my view, in that it does encourage people to think about things in their context and how there are different ways of understanding what is being said. And that's something that's come out loud and clear from these Speaker's Corner videos. The big point is that as power structures and controlling structures and as a way of dividing and ruling, if we, people of faith, allow that divide and rule strategy to overpower us, the power structures and their false idols win, because they're dividing people of faith to fight against each other while they get away with blue murder in the background. So people like Richard Dawkins, or Ricky Gervais, religion causes more wars than anything else. Well, religion is used as an excuse or a motivator in lots of wars, but you know what are wars? What's at the heart of them, really? You know, control, power over money, coinage, control of the populations, and you know, basically getting tribute from the different populations, and then maintaining control over those populations. And a really good way to do that, if you're a small elite of people, is to divide and rule. And that's something that is just shouted at me from these Speaker Courts Corner thing, where all these people are arguing over nitty-gritty points of semantic semiotics. It's true, they say the devil's in the detail. Well, you know, that's the devil's own word, you know. one of the most profound things I've read in the last 8 years, and I've read a lot the last 8 years, is quite a short book called Conversation with God by a guy called Neil Donald Walsh. And it's an amazing book. It took me ages to read. It's a slim volume, but it took me about 3 months to read it because I read every page about 100 times because it's very closely written, but in a very open way. But I've read quite a lot of philosophy, and there's a lot of philosophy, you know, in every line. It reminds, you know, it jogs something up. Oh, that's a bit like this, or that's a bit like that, or what's this, you know, what's that. And it's an incredible read, profound. And I think, I mean, in terms of motivations, I mean, if you read things with love in your heart and with trust in the sincerity of, you know, what's being put to you, then the good will shine through. But if you're looking for bad, you're going to find it, and you'll find it in anything. And I think if you're going to have a divide and rule strategy, that you're going to understand that actually that's what you would play on. I mean, if you had to think of a strategy to get people to argue amongst themselves and divide and rule, you would seek to undermine trust and get, you know, niggle away at people, so you put doubt in their mind. And it's a standard kind of psychological tactic, isn't it? A kind of gaslighting, isn't it? So it's been an interesting experience these last few days, watching so many of these Speakers' Corners videos. The David Lynn, the Pastor David Lynn thing is a really interesting one, because he's discussing things with, this isn't the one here, look, David Lynn, this chap's really humorous, but I'm not getting his name up here, where is he? This chap here is Ali Dawa. I mean, it doesn't matter, like, I mean, you can find the guy, and for goodness sake, just love each other, listen to each other, and learn from each other. And yeah, I'll get one now. Hold on, let me just stop this from going now. So the divide and rule point is the point which I've got to at the end of the three part two. In part one, we looked at the sort of the common root of the Abrahamic faiths, and then the various schism, say, between the Eastern Orthodox and the Church of Rome, and then the Protestant movements, and I mentioned Calvinism in dispatches, as it were. Now, in Jainism, there's a concept of many-sidedness, and this idea of many-sidedness is that you can look at things in seven different ways to distinguish different points. Now, in law, in a case with a precedent, you distinguish points of law and distinguish the facts of different cases to pull out of them the general principles that can then be applied to other cases. And so you distinguish the facts, or you can distinguish the law. And in theology, there's a lot of that goes on, and at the root of it all, in the Abrahamic faith, there's this idea of oneness and a non-corporeal, i.e. one Lord, God, Yahweh, Allah, you know, this one love, one love, one love. I mean, I think the Bob Marley song, One Love, is very good. I really dig Rastafarianism. I love listening to Rastafarian philosophy, and Jainism is, I find very, very interesting. But humanism and the humanist prayer, and it's very nice. All things like the golden rule. This discussion, understanding each other, loving each other, respecting each other idea, a common thread in things that I've read and thought, well, that's wisdom, that's a wise way of looking at things. I mean, in the Don O'Neill Walsh book, one amazing thing says is there are all times in life when everything seems to be going wrong, and really challenging times, the one question you need to ask is, what would love do now? And well, right at this time, what would love do now? Love forgives, it understands. It doesn't have to forget. Obviously we want to learn from our mistakes and what have you. But it's the idea of kind of letting go and moving past occasions where we mistrusted. Tarring everybody with the same brush is not a good way of going on. It's a great way of polarizing a debate. In logic, that's called syllogistic reasoning. A is B, therefore all A's are B. Sort of, there are various iterations of that, and they don't all work out. It doesn't always follow, and you end up, the famous one is the Black Swan, if you say all those swans are white, therefore all swans are white, well, there are black swans. So, so then you come to the crux of what all these guys are arguing about, and people get singled out, people like Tommy Robinson, people like Katie Hopkins, or say the BBC, and going to politics now, people are not nice about Laura Kuzenberg. Now, I can see that she's sort of quite often quite biased, but hey, she's doing a job, and might not like some of the points of view and all the rest of it, or even all of them. But it always pains me when people say, "Oh, we must get her sacked." That always really riles me, because everybody that needs to work and earn a living, it's a terrible thing to try and deprive them of the living. So I think that targeting people in that way is really not nice, it's not a very loving thing to do, is it? It's not a very forgiving thing to do. A lot of that has been going on with the sort of escalation to this divide and rule thing that's going on, this real heavy polarisation that we've seen in politics. I live in Sweden, it's happened here in Sweden. I'm often asked, what is it like in Sweden? What's really going on over there? I just see comments, Sweden is lost, or England is lost, and if it is lost, it's actually quite easy to find it again. And how you find it again is by trust and love, etc. And people that want to maintain a privileged position of chosenness, if you like, will do all in their power to make sure that people are fighting amongst themselves. That's the magician, when he's busy doing this with one hand, you need to wonder what's happening with the other hand. So that's really the point about many-sidedness, Jainism, the points of contradiction which Maimonides writes about. And then when it comes to talking to each other, talking at, past, or down to people, I don't know how anyone ever thinks that's going to work. You win over a lot more people by listening and showing that you understand the points that they're making. And then by all means distinguish your own points of difference to get to the core of an issue or the issues. There's a form of philosophy or a theory of philosophy called integral theory by an American philosopher called Ken Wilber. And integral theory is really useful. and it talks about, it has an acronym, AQL, all quarters, all levels. And it's to do with looking things from the inside out and from the outside in. I have that in mathematics as well. It's task is undecidability theory and Gödel's incompleteness theory. I mean, you can look it up. And read about what those things are. And what it basically says is all reasoning actually ends with an appeal to authority, because the only way of understanding any theory properly is to be able to look at it from the outside, and of course that's in an infinite universe is impossible. And so that's something that only a God would, you know, infinite awareness. Now, I think David Icke is a very wise man. I like David Icke. This term conspiracy theorist, I don't think David Icke's a conspiracy theorist at all. I think he's a wise man. And one of the things he says is about, you know, that we're all infinite awareness. And you say, well, that sounds a bit New Age and all the rest of it. And Ken Wilber might come across as quite New Age to lots of different people. But David Icke speaks up for love. What could be wrong with that? And then people say, oh no, but when he refers to lizards, he means Jews. I don't think he means that at all. It's a difficult concept, and it is esoteric, but there is a clip of Barack Obama referring to the oldest part of the brain, which is the lizard brain. Now, that it's a long way from that to this idea of shape-shifting and all the rest of it, but if you think about vibrating energy and about all things vibrate, get your head around that one. There's a poem by William Blake where he describes the shimmering of a tree's leaves. In my own head, he must mean a birch tree. I live in a forest in Sweden, and there are lots of birch trees. And this time of year, when you see the light shimmering in the little leaves of the birch trees, it shimmers. I mean, and that is Blake's poem. And it's also this idea of, you know, vibrating energy in the universe. But there are other poems as well that you know, refer that. The other person that does that, really what gets that across, is Van Gogh. And his way of painting, it's the moonlight one, the night sky one, that, you know, all swirly and all the rest of it. There was a scientific study that actually, you know, kind of said that his paintings really do almost model what they now understand as the vibrational energies and how things, the whole things vibrate. I mean, that's kind of getting off the point, but on the point, because trying to understand things is a lot harder than accepting and loving. What do they say? Sorry's the hardest word. That's probably fairly true as well. Actually, accepting an apology is quite a hard thing to do. Accepting a compliment is quite a hard thing to do. Well, that's one thing about Americans I quite like is Americans are good at accepting a compliment and saying you're welcome, you know, and accepting that with sincerity for a reserved Welshman like myself. I'm a little that reserved, but you know, that's, you know, something. I've spent time in America and I really kind of like that and kind of learned from the way how that works. So anyway, cultural enrichment, what's that all about? Well, immigration, the use of divide and rule to set people against each other is a strategy that's been employed by the powers of the for some time to undermine social contract. And when I've been in Sweden, there's always been everybody must have the same workplace protections so that that sort of undermining can't go on. And the EU institutionalised that sort of thing. If they didn't, the EU would be a better organisation. You know, Theresa May's government have, you know, undermined those sorts of things. I mean, that sort of thing has been undermined in Sweden. Germany as well, probably. But it's the breaking of the social contract, and the contract is broken by the powers that be who have an interest in dividing and ruling, and that's the important thing to remember. Now, the rest of us, you know, we need to love each other and stick together, but also let's love the powers that be as well, because they're human too. A good book to read on that is Pedagogy of the Oppressed by a guy called Paolo Freire. And it's a wonderful read. It's a nice read. It's not that long. And it kind of does walk through the idea of how in divide and rule strategies dehumanising the other, or the person that, or groups of people that you wish to oppress, is kind of part of the process. The flip side of that is that as part of the process of dehumanising, it reinforces the human connection in the person that's trying to do the dehumanising. Now, you know, when they train a soldier, they train the soldier to see the person they're killing not as a human being. That's what all this running at sort of dummies with bayonets fixed and all that, so that's all about, all the yelling and screaming and you know, well, neuro-linguistic programming that goes on to, you know, because it's not a nice thing to kill another human being. It's not a nice thing to kill anything, full stop. You know, we go through various ways of trying to justify it and all the rest of it. A word on halal. What that's about, it's not just you know, making sure the meat is clean or something like that. What it is if you're taking a life of something to eat it, you have to bless it and thank God and honour what you're taking your sustenance from. Now, and that that's an important thing to, you know, it's Like people say, oh, but you know, the way that they kill the other, that's inhumane and all this sort of thing. But if you look at the philosophical foundation of it, the, you know, that you're taking the life of a living thing, and therefore, you know, you need to honour that with respect. And it all, I mean, it all gets quite difficult and hard to talk about, but I have a blood brother who's a Muslim, Raz, and he's, you know, very, very dear friend and brother to me. And he's a Muslim. And I used to have an estate in England, and we weren't able to eat the game from the estate together, our deer. But we were able to when we had one deer that we were able to kill and bless us halal, and therefore we could actually have some barbecue deer together, which was really nice for me because, you know, Raz wouldn't have been able to eat it otherwise. So, well, I'm not a vegetarian. And I really like venison, and it was nice to be able to share it with my brother. So, Raz and I have spoken about Islam and Christianity, well, and Judaism as well, because I've got lots of Jewish friends, you know, we've talked about all of that stuff a lot. Now, this is an interesting story. Raz's father came to Britain in the 1940s, after the war, and he came because he was a prisoner of war fighting for the British Raj under an English major, and they were both imprisoned in a Japanese prisoner camp, and went through all of that together, and Raz's father kept this major alive through some pretty serious adversity. And so Raz's family came to Bristol, and his father and this major obviously had been through a lot together in the prisoner of war camp, and you know, were friends, and so, you know, I mean, Raz is as British as I am, but he's a devout Muslim, and yeah, here's me, I'm a Christian, this major, he was a Christian, but you know, let's remember that and honour that. And it's not like an isolated case of, you know, how far back and how deep and strong the bonds are between people of different faiths who have a common heritage, really, and the, without getting into all the stuff about imperialism and colonialism and those kind of power doings, if you like, we ordinary folk have got serious, strong history together. I mean, another one of my favourite stories is when Gandhi came to Britain in the 1930s, when they were spinning their own homespun cloth, and it was affecting the cotton mills in Yorkshire, but Gandhi was welcomed, and the people in those factories were really, really supportive of the Indian people and their struggle against, you know, the powers that be, if you like, and the oppression there, because they themselves were oppressed, and that was a real bond. Now, that kind of social history isn't something which gets a lot of newspaper inches, and there's a good reason for that. It's because it helps if you want to run an elitist form of government to, you know, keep all the plebs arguing amongst themselves. And the truth is that regardless of faith groupings, colour, dress, whatever, um, 95% of people have way more in common with each other than divides them. And I wrote a poem called Bourgeois Resolution. That's what that's about. It's about the how it's the courtiers around the monarchs or the aristocracy or whatever that keep everybody else in order. That's what the Uncle Tom thing is about in terms of slavery and you know, the slave masters in that sort of episode of, you know, the way that the oppression was kept going was by having this hierarchy and putting these piggy in the middle type things going on. You know, that's why getting rid of local police forces is a bad idea. Getting rid of army regiments that are associated with geographical areas it's a bad idea, because tyrants have always employed mercenaries to do their dirty work because they find it much easier to other themselves. Just remember you're being played. That is the modus operandi at the moment of the what I would call the kakistocracy. You know, our leadership at the present time are not doing a very good job, and they haven't been doing a very good job for some period of time. And that's deeply disappointing and troubling. But power does throw from the people, you know, Magna Carta and the Charter of the Forests and all the rest of it, back to the peasants' revolt, Wat Tyler and all of that. Another interesting story from Sweden. Back in the 1780s, one of the monarchs tried to sort of take away the power from the parliament and get foreign bodies involved to re-establish the monarchy. And this was found out, and basically they were called into parliament and told in no uncertain terms that power flows from the people, you can't do that. It's an episode in Swedish history. But if you look at Sweden and the efforts to divide and rule here, you know, I see it here, and I see it really quite clearly in the UK as well. And of course you see it in the Middle East, and in South America, and it's not the American people or the American public. It's a, you know, a group of, or several groups of, well, basically gangsters. You know, that's the problem that we all face, and there are problems with the Muslim rape gangs, and there were cover-ups of that, and that is a stain on, you know, those groups and the, you know, and communities feel that. And if you listen to these guys at Speaker's Corner, they all say that. Ali Darwar says that. You see these people desperate to win arguments and all the rest of it. And they'll say, oh, but you said this, you said that. You know, they're accusing people of all sorts of atrocities and terrible things. Who aren't responsible for them is a, you know, it's a standard tactic of adversarial debate. So, just one other thing on discourse and talking, teaching. This David Lean and this chap here. This idea of, well, I'm here to teach, or I'm here to preach, and, you know, you can't teach me anything, and all of this sort of thing. That kind of goes on between the two of those. There's a book written by Lucian called The Sale of Creeds, or a, whatever it is, a discourse, I suppose. And The Sale of Creeds is about different philosophers being sold as slaves in the slave market, in the slave market, and Pythagoras comes up, and the says, "What's your creed? What will you teach me?" And Pythagoras says, "I will not teach you. I will remind you." And that's kind of stuck with me. And Lucian makes me laugh. He's a very witty chap, but. I will not teach you, I will remind you. I mean, there's a lot in that, and so two ears, one mouth, and, you know, I will not teach you, I'll remind you. And I think the same thing goes for writing as well. I think you have to read a lot to write anything, otherwise. You know, we can all chat on, and it's, you know, that's fun, but by listening and reading, yeah, we can broaden our understanding and push the boundaries of our own self-knowledge, self-love, and ability to love each other. And so all this celebrating people being convicted here and there, or, you know, accusing people of being all manner of terrible things, you know, is human nature basically good or bad? I believe it's good. Lots of people think, well, that's a naive thing to say. What about all the bad in the world? And you know, and many people use that sort of, well, you know, well, there can't be a God if there's bad in the world. And that's a common sort of essay to set, I suppose, for theology students, or, you know, atheist students, whatever. Yeah, then we come to the idea of free will or determinism, and Parmenides and Heraclitus, and I believe in free will. And that's one of the roots of the splits and the anathematization of certain teachings from Orthodox and early Christianity, which became heterodox or were considered heterodox when they lost the political battle with Constantine. So that's the Arian heresy and the Pelagian heresies. And Augustine won the political battle, whereby the tendency of the one is to authority and the other liberty. In my own humble view, that's where they boil ultimately down to. And I'm a Christian anarchist. And anarchy is probably as badly misrepresented as Islam, or Judaism, or indeed Christianity in the modern world. And anarchy is an absence of hierarchy, not an absence of laws. It's laws without violence, without coercion. So where does that all lead back to with this now? Well, for me, I shall be using some of these dialogues to sort of condense them down into my Glastonbury romp at the end of Conquest of Doe, and my hero, the guardian of the Doe, I think is going to have to pass through Speaker's Corner to catch a lift up to Glastonbury, I think. So thanks guys, I've had an enjoyable several days listening to you guys at Speaker's Corner, and jolly interesting it has been too. Love each other, and you know, listen to each other, and learn from each other. God bless you all, and I think it's been good. I'm an eternal optimist, so I've been quite optimistic from watching it all. So there we are, it's part 3.